Hello and welcome from me, Mike Scott, in Oxford, to this, the fourth event in the second year of our Christian Literary Imagination series. The series is a Georgetown University's Humanities Initiative in association with Campion Hall, Oxford, and the Las Casas Institute, Blackfriars Hall, Oxford. Today, Father Joseph Simmons, SJ, from Campion Hall, will be welcoming Charles Tung from Seattle, who will be talking about H.G. Wells's World Brain, Teilhard de Chardin's New Sphere, and the University at the End of the World. After his talk, Charles will take questions submitted from members of our internationally based audience and put them, and they will be put to him by Father Joe. We encourage you to participate by typing your questions directly to us from the moment we begin the session. You can do so by using the Q&A key at the bottom of your screen. If you have a question or questions, please ask them and we will endeavour to answer them either today or later by email. So without more ado, I will hand you over to Father Joe and I'll see you at the end of the session. Enjoy it. Father Joe.
Thank you, Michael. Today we welcome Dr. Charles Tung, Professor and Department Chair of English at Seattle University, the premier Jesuit University of Western Washington State. There are two Jesuit universities in Washington. Dr. Tung completed his doctorate in 20th century British and American literature at the University of California, Berkeley in 2004. He completed a master's in English literature at St. Cross College here at the University of Oxford about a decade before then, having received the first Father Timothy S. Healy Scholarship from Georgetown University, where he did his undergraduate studies in English. Professor Tung's 2020 book, Modernism and Time Machines, is part of the Critical Studies in Modernist Culture series put out by the Edinburgh University Press. He also has research interests in race and atavism, models of history and identity in culture and ethnic studies, and time travel narratives. This all seems fitting given that I'm 8 hours in the future relative to him. As Professor Scott mentioned, a reminder that during his talk, you can add your questions to the Q&A button below. Please do so so that we can have a robust conversation as we often do in our series. Without further ado, Professor Tung presents his paper, H.G. Wells' World Brain, Pierre Teilhard de Chardin's Noosphere, and the University at the End of the World. Charles, over to you.
Thank you so much for that introduction, Father Simmons, and thank you for the invitation to speak in this series, Dr. Scott. It's a real honor for me to be here virtually at Georgetown, where I was an undergrad over 30 years ago, and virtually at Oxford, where I began my graduate studies. I can see here, too, that I'm in the presence of several of my undergrad professors to whom I remain so grateful. I hope that some of the risks I'm going to take today with some of my underbaked ideas will generate at least a few useful, interesting provocations for conversation for us to think together. So I'm speaking to you today from Seattle, which is on the homelands of the Coast Salish peoples. Continue to steward these lands and waters today, and where my university is located, a Jesuit institution where I've taught for the last 18 years. Okay, I'm just going to share screen with you right now. In recent years, high-profile institutionalized plans for the end of the world have appeared with increasing frequency. For example, the Svalbard Global Seed Vault was built by the Norwegian government and food security scientists in 2008 to back up and perhaps one day to salvage agricultural biodiversity. The Long Now Foundation, whose 10,000-year clock is a kind of vanity projection of millennium-scale survival of human beings, began an archive in 2014 called the Manual for Civilization, a collection of 3,500 books of culture, engineering, and rigorous science fiction, and long-term thinking meant to help human beings, quote, sustain or rebuild civilization. If you've been paying attention to the news in the last 5 to 10 years, you know that billionaire preppers are building bunkers, luxury arcs for riding out the apocalypse. In contemporary fiction, in the flood of recent techno-ecological dystopias, there are many scenes of instruction that bob up and down like flotsam. Scenes of people learning things, scenes that express the desire that human knowledge continue to be transmissible into the far future, scenes that express the suspicion that knowledge institutions are somehow implicated in the disaster. So for the purposes of this talk today, I'd like to group these scenes that I'm going to share with you under the heading, The University at the End of the World. Let me share a few of these scenes with you in the chronological order of their publication. First, in Margaret Atwood's opening novel of her Mad Atom trilogy, Oryx and Crake, two of the main characters leave their corporate gated communities to attend very different institutions of higher ed. One goes to the highly corporatized Watson Crick Institute, specializing, unsurprisingly, in bioengineering. And the other goes to the equally corporatized but less prestigious humanities institution, the Martha Graham Academy. At the latter, the curriculum has shifted to contemporary arenas. Just going to switch the slide there. Contemporary arenas from which you could still go into advertising, no sweat. And the protagonist, Jimmy, chooses a career-ready marketing-focused major called Problematics, which hilariously requires such courses as Applied Logic, Applied Rhetoric, Applied Semantics, Relativistics, and Advanced Mischaracterization. While books 2 and 3 follow an eco-terrorist religious sect called God's Gardeners across the trilogy's apocalyptic event of a virus intentionally designed to wipe out the human species, Oryx and Crake tracks the creation of genetically improved, gentle herbivore humans. After human history has been reset to zero, these new humans are tutored by the humanities major, Jimmy, whose storytelling ability is comically unskillful. Second, in Emily St. John Mandel's 2014 novel, Station 11, after a virus from the Republic of Georgia has wiped out most of the world's population, stranding flyers in the Severn City Airport, those flyers form a settlement there that lasts for 20 years, during which one of the side characters begins a Museum of Civilization in what had formerly been the Sky Miles Lounge in Concourse C. As the curator of this museum in a world without electricity, Clark Thompson, the character, collects obsolete laptops, iPhones, the radio from an administrative desk, the electric toaster from an airport staff lounge, the turntable and vinyl records. That was a quote. He also serves as a teacher who lays out the context, the pre-pandemic world that he remembered so sharply. The main drama of the book revolves around a parallel model of instruction, the Traveling Symphony, a group of musicians and actors who travel the Great Lakes region heavily armed, performing jazz, classical, and pop, as well as performing Shakespeare plays for survivors living in old fast food restaurants and gas stations. And finally, Nnedi Okorafor's African Futurist trilogy, which spans 2015 to 2018. In this trilogy, a young Himba woman named Binti is the first of her people from Namibia to be accepted to the Intergalactic Institution of Higher Ed, UMSA University. In the first book, no catastrophe has yet befallen our planet, although in books 2 and 3, the dominant ethnic group on Earth, the Kush, will be engulfed in a war with jellyfish aliens called the Medusa. On her way to UMSA University, which is a distant planet with 10 departments that are each their own city, Binti is caught up in the start of the interstellar conflict sparked by a pedagogical display of which she was unaware. UMSA UMSA University's Department of Weapons City, Weapons Department, has a museum that has on exhibit a part of the Medusa Chief's jellyfish body, his stinger. Only two other departments are named in the book, Math City and Organics City. But the book itself, one might imagine, is part of the tenure file of a professor from Alternate History City. Like Afrofuturism and other kinds of ethnofuturist cultural production, Nnedi Okorafor's African Futurism is concerned to center the existence of minoritized populations, not just in the present, but also in the future, where they are often erased or not represented, and often by recovering some repressed or forgotten history or past. My thesis today is going to join together several arguments from different domains to address the question of what instruction and learning entail at the end of the world or in anticipation of the end of the world. My response to this question is going to move first to that dream of social evolution and human progress that informs the science fiction writer H.G. Wells' plan for a unifying world brain, and Pierre Teilhard de Chardin's Noosphere. Teilhard de Chardin was a Jesuit priest who was a paleontologist, theologian, and philosopher who came up with this idea of the noosphere. And I'm going to suggest that the developments presaged by these 20th century ideas have not materialized as answers to catastrophe, but as accessories to it. I'm going to tack back from these 1920s and 30s concepts to Wells's earlier and first device for thinking forward to the far future, the trope of the time machine. This literary technology, I think, can help us produce a way of thinking about time and history that allows us to shift our thinking about the end of the world from a discrete event to multiple processes. There are many ends of the world, and some of them have been ongoing for a lot longer than we think. This way of thinking allows us to acknowledge that our knowledge institutions in the West have to varying degrees been implicated in different human and non-human or environmental catastrophes and their histories, while not foreclosing the question of what universities and education can and ought to do. I'll try to end today with a suggestion that in the viral cultures that we currently inhabit, tilting our critical frame from the temporality and the time of a singular ending of things, shifting from that to multiple histories of their aftermaths and the after effects, can really help us to see that there are many sites of struggle. And I'm hoping that it'll help us fortify what I'll call an archaeological futurist spirit. In other words, to not give up on a better past is to keep faith with the project of unearthing fragments of those new and alternative futures that could emerge from the many histories that are already in motion. I'm going to just move the slide here and start talking about Wells, who in 1936 to 38 delivered a series of lectures and essays that were collected in a volume called World Brain. In some of those essays and lectures, Wells says that, quote, the original university idea was simply gatherings of eager people who wanted to know, clustered around teachers who did seem to know, end quote. His proposal for a world brain cleaves to this original idea. In the space between what he saw as the greatest catastrophe in history, World War I, and on the eve of another world war, Wells wanted to write the next chapter of the story of education, a chapter on, quote, the world's knowledge apparatus, a sequence that goes, quote, after the lecture room, the book. After that, the newspaper, universal education, the cinema, the radio, followed then by the world brain. Wells noted that this story would have to involve a change of scale, even after the First World War, it, quote, it was no longer possible to live in little horse and foot communities. And then in the late 1930s, quote, we can speak to anyone anywhere so soon as the proper connections have been made. And in a little while, we shall be able to look one another in the face from the ends of the earth, end quote. If, as he claimed, human beings' heredity seemed to have changed very little, if at all, since the Stone Age, and the whole property money system needs revision, and the recrudescence of sentimental nationalism, largely through misguided school teaching and newspaper propaganda, is becoming an increasing menace to world welfare, end quote, then the world brain is the only alternative to social dissolution. Wells construes this brain variously as a collectively authored world encyclopedia, a super university, an organization like a nervous network, a system of mental control that should extend its informing tentacles to every intelligent individual in the New World community. For Wells, the choice human beings are faced with is, quote, either the evolution of a new, more powerful type of human being or the extinction of our species, end quote. While Wells spoke out against Christianity's entanglements with priestcraft and princes, he was interested in the way, quote, the Catholic Church provided what the Roman Republic had lacked, a system of popular teaching, a number of universities and methods of intellectual intercommunication, end quote. As the literary critic Jeffrey DeLeo points out, Wells actually retains religiosity for his vision of education, subtracting only the narrowness and anti-cosmopolitan tendencies recorded in the history of organized religion. Here's a quote from Wells. Our true nationality is mankind. Education must become, again, in intention and spirit, religious. The impulse to devotion, to universal service, and to a complete escape from the self will reappear again as the recognized fundamental structural impulse in human society, end quote. To prevent another world war, Wells proposed an education system that, as the scholar W. Warren Wagar argued, would have used scientific knowledge to, quote, transform all men and women everywhere into servants of the emerging racial or collective mind, a unitary organism defined by enlightened despotism and technological utopia. The developments in information science necessary for a world brain level of connection and scale of archive, as the cyberneticist Francis Haligan recounts, range back to Diderot's Enlightenment Encyclopedia, Paul Otley's 19th century documentation system of index cards, and the ongoing march of hypertext linking, web addressing, and wiki sourcing systems over the last 50 years. One doesn't have to be a social theorist to conclude that this knowledge apparatus has not worked the way Wells thought it would. Scaling up the original university idea has not produced a unified, highly evolved world brain. The same is the case for Teilhard de Chardin's concept of the noosphere, with neither Wells or Teilhard to blame, just to be clear. In a 1947 essay called The Formation of the Noosphere, Teilhard described the noosphere as, quote, the added planetary layer, an envelope of thinking substance growing out of the biosphere, which has relied upon a cerebral apparatus, quote, the extraordinary network of radio and television communications, which perhaps anticipating the direct syntonization of brains through the mysterious power of telepathy, already links us all in a sort of etherized universal consciousness, end quote. This network of material instruments are finally nothing less than the manifestation of a particular kind of superbrain. In Teilhard's eschatological evolutionary framework, this connective tissue, digital for us now, allowing for the scaling up of second order consciousness. What does that mean? The fact not just that we know, but that we are earthly matter that now knows that it knows. This connective tissue for Teilhard brings about a second phase of hominization itself, of becoming human fully, more fully. In his 1945 essay, A Great Event Foreshadowed the Planetization of Mankind, while the end of the Second World War, one might conclude that human beings have never more vehemently rebuffed and detested one another than they do now, when everything drives them closer together, Teilhard optimistically detected a new element not yet cataloged. Homo progressivus, a person to whom the future matters more than the present. Today, if we think about the synthetization of brains through social media and what it's done to our politics here in the United States, it's arguable that planetization has become less possible rather than more. Scientific knowledge is on its back foot. The networked super university, the world brain, has become a manipulative tracker, monetizing all aspects of our pathways through digital space, our data exhaust. Homo progressivus as a high point on the ladder of vitalist evolution, on its way to the omega point of techno-scientific singularity, seems a very long ways off. One way to make use of the world brain and noospheric thinking is to bracket the teleology, this drive toward a singular endpoint, and to just avail ourselves of the value of H.G. Wells's and Teilhard de Chardin's scalar zoom, the ability to scale up to zoom in and out. The concern that both thinkers had for temporal scale and planetary scope allows us to reconfigure hopeful possibilities by first acknowledging the complicity of progressive, unified, unitary history. What is it complicit in? In this article by Boris Soshitaisvili in his essay, From the Anthropocene to the Noosphere, The Great Acceleration, the complicity is with this mid-20th century set of conditions called the Great Acceleration that indicate that the human species has become a geological force in the most negative world-altering sense. Paul Crutzen, the scientist who, together with Eugene Sterma, popularized the term Anthropocene to name the geological epoch of humans, puts it this way. Here's the quote I'm going to read. Will the Anthropocene simply turn out to be a very short era in which humanity blindly careens forward, continuing to transform the Earth until the planet loses its capacity to support us? Or might humanity rise to the challenge, becoming the reflective, thinking, and proactive agent that transforms the biosphere into a noosphere, and consciously striving to shape a niche for ourselves in a sustainable Anthropocene? What type of thinking, reflection, and proaction would be necessary? For the literary critic Timothy Wienson, Teilhard's writing represents, quote, perhaps the most important early 20th century attempt to understand the species as a force on a geological scale, end quote. On this scale, future natural history is simultaneously the history of modernity, the history of technology, the history of culture. But it is not just going big that matters. The challenge is, as the historian Deepesh Chakrabarty has put it, The challenge is, quote, to think human agency over multiple and incommensurable scales at once, to take the necessity of thinking disjunctively, to undertake the necessity of thinking disjunctively. So thinking on multiple scales, not just the scale of human history, but the scale, for instance, of planetary history, and there are other kinds of human history as well. To do this entails, as Chakrabarty's earlier work in postcolonial studies shows, to do this entails reconceptualizing the present, to think the now that we inhabit as we speak as irreducibly not one. That's a really tough idea, but to unpack it is to really see that we want to desingularize the present. And when we do that, we're entertaining the idea that there's more than one history and more than one scale of history, and that that is not a psychological or a narrative fact. It's a temporal historical one. The Wells in his late 20s is better for thinking about disjunctive and incommensurate scales than the Wells in his 70s. His important 1895 novel, The Time Machine, is not just about sliding 801,000 years and then 30 million years into the future and back. Like many canonical modernist paintings and literary works in this period, Wells's novel seeks to defamiliarize time itself, to make it strange by exploring different rates of passage, by exploring a variety of scales and shapes of time space, and by exploring a plurality of timelines and histories. The science fiction novelist Harry Turtledove has pointed out that, quote, we're all time travelers. We all go into the future at a steady rate of 1 second per second, end quote. But Wells's vehicle of time travel helped to make strange the very medium in which we live by featuring a device able to manipulate, outstrip, and negate the putatively universal pace of 1 second per second, the common sense rate of temporal passage itself. In Wells's novel, the speed of the traveler's machine relative to the rate at which his late 19th century dinner guests experience time varies from, quote, over a year a minute to a pace so fast that the thousands of days hand on his dial was sweeping round as fast as the seconds hand of a watch. And it goes from there to the unimaginably, quote, great strides of 1,000 years or more, end quote. The critical and imaginative power of such an ability, as Wells's time traveler points out on the first page of the story, consists in the fact that it, quote, can controvert ideas that are almost universally accepted. More than a decade before Albert Einstein, Wells's novel shows that a second does not always elapse in a second as a second. While Wells does not explicitly engage the issue of the number of timelines produced by the machine, his novel contains the seed of a whole subgenre of science fiction, that is the subgenre of alternate history with its proliferation of timelines. Wells's plot does not extend to the possible consequences of his traveler's intervention in the Eloy's and the Morlock's history, or the after effects of his preemptively moralizing tale about Victorian class divisions. And yet the structure of his novel, as Alana Gomel argues, pits the implication of alternate history against the block universe presupposed by forward time travel. The embedding narrative told by the unnamed narrator contains, quote, the deterministic chronotope of time travel, in which all past and future time is spatialized as a block and therefore traversable. But the embedded narrative told by the traveler himself employs a different chronotope, the chronotope of alternative history, in which history is contingent and the future is unknowable. This second understanding of the way time and space are connected reconfigures our vision of time as a progressive or regressive line, at the very least, into a set of open-ended fields that the time machine's journey has in fact shaped and altered. Wells left the implications to our imagination and to the many science fiction writers that followed him, but his novel's utopian investment in evaluating Victorian industrial capitalism suggests very strongly and tantalizingly a timescape in which alternate histories are not only possible, but are already cutting across the present. As the philosopher Ernst Bloch pointed out about the remnants of different parts of the past that coexist together simultaneously, history, this is a quote, history is no entity advancing along a single line, but it is a polyrhythmic and multispatial entity, end quote. This more complex picture of the period's time culture in the early 20th century, late 19th, is characterized by what John May and Nigel Thrift describe as, quote, a growing awareness of living within a multiplicity of times, a number of which might be moving at different speeds and even in different directions, end quote. Lefebvre described this multiplicity as heterogeneous rhythms whose relations of a time with a space, a localized time, or a temporalized space allows for multiplicity. And Lefebvre goes on to describe these different rhythms themselves as concrete times. They're not just different tempos within a singular time, an absolute temporal container, the very thing that Einstein rejected in his general and special theories of relativity. In my view of 20th century literature and art, there is a clear strain of non-subjective rejections, repudiations of the one true time of the public clock. And for those of you who are interested in early 20th century literature, just think for a minute about T.S. Eliot's heterochronic cityscapes, where things are happening at different rates and are marked by different ages that are still present, that are still running. Think about Virginia Woolf's many different imperfectly synchronized clocks in her novels and the different spaces that those unsynchronized clocks organize. Think about William Faulkner's jeweler's shop window filled with unregulated watches, unset watches, and the juxtaposition in his work of racial time lag, regional time lag of the South, for instance, and the contrast of that with a progressive industrialized North. The literary scholar David Wittenberg has argued that, quote, narrative itself is a time machine, and literature itself might be viewed as a subtype of time travel rather than the other way around, end quote. If modernist literature specifically aspired to the condition of a time machine, it was a distinctly non-narrative one, an experimental one, that reworked everything from what Virginia Woolf called, quote, the formal railway line of a sentence, from that to plot structure itself. Modernist texts are not linear in their structure. So it was not simply a vehicle moving us back and forth in time, or even a vehicle that had a view of the rails and the tracks below. Rather, it was a machine that defamiliarizes and reconfigures the very medium that narrative is meant to organize, and that produces a variety of time spaces, a variety of histories. from this peculiar perspective, time machinic perspective, let me circle back now to those scenes of the university at the end of the world, their deep anxiety about informational and biosocial virality, even I would say ontological contagion. And let me circle back also to Nnedi Okorafor's explicit reference to the role of knowledge institutions in racial and ecological violence. All of the scenes that I shared with you earlier, so briefly, I admit, are from texts that are, as the critic Andrew Hoberek says of Station 11, quote, they're not about the post-apocalyptic future, but a post-apocalyptic present, end quote. I understand this description of the present to mean what Indigenous scholars have been pointing out in recent debates about the Anthropocene, this new geological epoch in which humans are a major geological force. For example, as Kyle White writes, Indigenous peoples have already endured ecosystem collapse, species loss, economic crash, drastic relocation, and cultural disintegration, end quote. In the histories of Indigenous peoples, the apocalypse began hundreds of years ago and is ongoing. So I want to begin to wrap up this talk by showing you this winter count from 1800 to 1898. Which was kept by Chief Swift Bear's family in what is now called South Dakota. It is a pictographic chronicle or ideographic history inscribed on an animal hide of major events worth remembering each year. And between the first snowfalls of 1879 and 1880, this Lakota winter count records boys, girls taken by Major Richard Henry Pratt, who at the time was a first lieutenant. Pratt, between 1879 and 1880, took 82 students from the Lakota tribes at Rosebud and Pine Ridge to the boarding school he had just founded, the infamous Carlisle Indian Industrial School in Pennsylvania. He took these children over 1,000 miles away from their home. Having participated in the Washita Massacre in 1868, 1869, and the Red River War that violently displaced tribes from the Southern Great Plains, maybe 5 years after that, this guy Pratt thought that his work as the new superintendent of this school, the school system, something that theorists would call an ideological settler state apparatus. He thought of his work there to be in benevolent contrast to his military service. But in a very notorious and well-known 1892 speech, he remarked, a great general has said that the only good Indian is a dead one. In a sense, I agree with that sentiment, but only in this, that all the Indian there is in the race should be dead. Kill the Indian in him and save the man. In June of this year, 2021, the Smithsonian Magazine reported that the remains of 10 children at the Carlisle Indian School, 10 children of more than 180 Native children who died at Carlisle, often from a combination of malnourishment, sustained abuse, and disease brought on by poor living conditions. That's a quote from the Smithsonian article itself. Those 10 children would finally be making the journey home to their families. This year alone, the remains of over 1,000 students have been found in masked and unmarked graves in North American residential schools. In the U.S., the Indian boarding schools grew out of an 1819 act called the Indian Civilization Fund Act. And this act kickstarted and supported the educational civilization process in Christian and Catholic missionary institutions that attempted to wipe out Indigenous cultures, languages, and ways of being. When I think about the complex connections of educational institutions to different paths that are now being unearthed, I think about what Mark Rifkin says in his book, Beyond Settler Time, Temporal Sovereignty and Indigenous Self-Determination. Rifkin says that against the idea of simply constructing a more inclusive version of history, a more inclusive version of the present, Indigenous people seek both to critique notions, narratives, and experiences of temporality that de facto normalize non-Native presence, influence, and occupation. That was a quote. And that Indigenous people seek to insist on multiple frames of reference, temporal sovereignty, rather than temporal recognition within a present coevalness, a present simultaneity. Oops, I won't talk about that slide, talk about that one. In opposition to a universal history as a, quote, singular temporal formation that itself marks the sole possibility for moving into the future, Mark Rifkin adapts Einstein's work on temporal reference frames in order to create the possibility of different futures that arrive within differently paced, non-synchronous, non-simultaneous, but often intersecting histories. What must universities do and be to make this happen? I'm almost done here. I'll end with this provocation. We're in a moment characterized by what Burton Clark called the entrepreneurial university. This is a 1998 book that he wrote. Similar to Atwood's Institutes, Margaret Atwood's Institutes in that scene I shared with you earlier. The University of Utility, which the education scholar Ronald Barnett says, quote, has become dominant all over the world. It is understandable if some feel that the history of the idea of the university is at an end, end quote. The idealization of the University of Reason, in which scholars and teachers have autonomy from the state to pursue knowledge and truth, and in which students come to begin the German education theorist and philosophers, Wilhelm von Humboldt's ultimate task, his idea of this ultimate task of giving, quote, the fullest possible content to the concept of humanity in our own person, end quote. That idea has some bodies buried beneath it that continue to be unearthed. In Bill Redding's estimation, in his pretty well-known book, The University in Ruins, already more than 25 years old, quote, the grand narrative of the university centered on the cultural production of a liberal, reasoning, citizen subject in the wake not just of this neoliberalism, but also of globalization is no longer credible. Excellence has become the last unifying principle of the modern university, and yet the discourse of excellence brackets out the question of value in favor of measurement and substitutes accounting solutions for questions of accountability, end quote. We know that the preparation for the public sphere has to be preparation for multiple publics. We know that preparation at the university has to be preparation for critique, for different histories and different scales of disaster that are coming down the pike at us. As Eva Domanska puts it, quote, we need the kind of knowledge, cognition, and human sciences that have survival value and might help us in the protection and continuation of the species, end quote. This species emphasis is no longer the universality of humanism. It is about the rearrangement of knowledge and what we dig up that locates human beings in a number of different tangles with social, animal, ecological, technological strands and in a variety of apocalyptic historical trajectories that contain different futures. It is a non-anthropocentric agenda with a reconfigured system of ethics that many scholars are now calling post-human. Thanks very much for listening, and I'll turn it back over to Father Joe now.
Thank you very much, Charles. Stimulating and robust paper, and I think we'll have a number of questions that people can send again to the Q&A, and they'll get passed on to me. I have some questions just to sort of kick things off. The first one, when you were talking about time and futures and different futures, is reminded of the line from William Faulkner's, I think it was Requiem for a Nun, that line, that great line, the past is never dead, it's not even past. And maybe the future is not even future. Do you have any thoughts on that line or how that might kind of align with when you discussed modernist literature's play, kind of creative play with time of past and present and future? Any thoughts on that, especially in light of what you're talking about with the Lakota Sioux tribe?
Yes, absolutely. I think modernism was very interested in grappling with and pushing back against this idea of a universal clock time that really was born in the 19th century as a result of railway companies and also, you know, naval necessities and maritime commerce. You know, how do you coordinate shipping via rail and via boat? And for the clock, as soon as one moment ticks away, it's gone. It's the past. And this sort of way of thinking organized this whole attitude toward leaving the past behind and really moving forward into the future. I mean, we can hear this in discourses at the university now that are obsessed with innovation and, you know, what Harvard Business School types call disruptivation. And against that, I think, you know, a lot of early 20th century, late 19th century painters, writers, philosophers were very interested in thinking about how the past doesn't disappear at all, but continues to haunt the present, to remain in the present, and to have to contain within it new potentials for the future, that is returning to some of those ghosts, returning to history, to the past, is deeply valuable, not just in its own right, but for the possibilities held in germ form, in seed form there. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that answers your question, Father Joe.
Yeah, I think so, certainly. And you know, you mentioned Virginia Woolf, whom I work on and love quite a bit. She talks about the angel of the house that haunts every early 20th century British household with Victorian sensibilities, that this angel of the house was sort of hovering there, which was responsible for Victorian religiosity and sort of the woman's place in the home. And so she did everything she could to cast that angel of the house out by throwing her ink pot at it, which I think was a reference to Martin Luther trying to cast the devil out. So this idea that the past, the families, the Wolf's family history kind of haunting her, and that kind of plays into and bleeds into her own writing, fiction and essay alike. But I want to kind of turn back to, somebody asked Brian Alexander in a crowd, he says, writing about this question of time, that it reminds him of Kim Stanley Robinson's argument that historical fiction and science fiction are structurally similar. Are you familiar with this idea? I'm not myself, of Kim Stanley Robinson, about the similarity and structure between historical fiction and science fiction?
Yes, thanks for that question, Brian Alexander. I think I follow your posts on the Remaking the University Facebook group, and it's great to see you here and to hear this question. A lot of people are talking about a lot of literary scholars, contemporary literary scholars are arguing that the best realistic mode for the present is science fiction. The best way of thinking historically about the present is to write in this future-oriented mode of science fiction. So yes, I think that to think about older definitions of historical fiction and their relationship to reality, to what is present, and to ask how that would best capture the strange world we live in now really requires us to think about the present as being organized and structured around assumptions about the future, about ideas and fantasies about the future. And that really makes science fiction this, for many scholars, this privileged mode of representation for contemporary life, of contemporary life. I don't know if that properly answers Brian Alexander's question, but I really appreciate that question. And it's a rich one.
Well, we have a number of questions, and so perhaps you and Brian can connect offline. So Brian, if you could maybe send on to Professor Tung your email address if you're not already connected in the chat function. Let's see here. One of the questions has to do with sort of how does this sort of the end of the world science fiction, how did you see that squaring in any way with sort of the conception of the second coming or the end of time in Christian time where everything kind of comes together? So the specific question was, if the idea of the university of reason, one that promotes knowledge and truth, is coming to an end, what happens to the concept of truth itself? Does it give way politically to the domination of strong dictatorship or to reconsideration of our current concept of liberal democracy or to the anarchy of chaos as the two war against one another? In other words, this end of the world, what does it look like? And does it square at all with sort of a Christian vision of the end of times? Or are these two kind of totally different spheres, do you think?
Yeah, that's a great question, a very complex one too. Let me see if I can attempt a coherent answer to it. You know, Father Teilhard de Chardin's interest as a paleontologist, his interest in history as a paleontologist and then as a theologian, as a philosopher of history, was very much interested in this omega point, this end of history that you know would really be the second coming, the apocalyptic revelation that would materialize as a result of this kind of world brain type unification of human being and human thinking and human reflective powers. I guess that my own position would be not so much to negate that as to pluralize it, to say that that is one way of thinking about history and it shouldn't be ended. But we have to think simultaneously and disjunctively through, across, and in different models of history. There are other endings. There are other historical trajectories. And I would say too, I ended, you know, with that quote by Bill Reddings from the University in Ruins about, you know, the production of a liberal rational citizen subject, he says, is no longer credible. And I guess my qualification of that position would be that it's no longer credible as the only narrative of the university. We certainly don't want to stop producing reasonable citizen subjects who are committed to liberal democracy, but we want to be able to step outside that history and understand some of its shortcomings and its problems, and to also to understand other histories, other political histories, other educational histories that, again, provide us with new potentials, new possibilities for the future.
Thank you. We're going to have to end with one more question in a second, but I just thought I'd mention that I taught as a Jesuit novice about, gosh, 15 years ago now at the Red Cloud Indian Reservation School in the Lakota Sioux with the Lakota Sioux Indians. And they have a deep memory of history, and indeed, to underscore what you're saying, a very different sense of history. Whereas for us, the 1970s seems like maybe forever ago, the American Indian movement lives very strong in the memory, and the battle of Wounded Knee, which was took place in the 1870s, and then the second battle of Wounded Knee took place 100 years later. You just see sort of kind of these histories coming together and the different conceptions of history being kind of clashing, but presenting different possibilities for future, I think, for the people on the reservation. So that's a conversation we'd be having. I want to give the last word to John Hirsch, who has an interesting question and hopefully a relatively easy one, given all of the complexities that we brought up today. Going back to Wells himself, is there any sense in his book, The Time Machine, or elsewhere, of a kind of post-human future that reflects back on the pre-apocalyptic present, what we would consider the present? Do you know of anything where he has the characters reflecting back on our current time or Wells's time?
Yes, I mean, I think the whole book does precisely that. The whole book shoots forward to the future in order to think of, the traveler himself is trying to speculate on what has produced this future. And so part of the traveler's speculations are that it was 19th century class society that brought this about. Maybe it was socialism, maybe it was unbridled capitalism. I mean, all of these speculations are very explicit in the text and allow us to think forward from the present, as well as to think historically about what produced the present. That remains implicit in the book. If I could just for 30 seconds say something quickly to what you were saying, Father Joe, about the reservations. I just wanted to say briefly that my own interest in this comes from the fact that, my family moved to Arizona in 1908. And Arizona, this was before it was a state, it was the Arizona Territory, and Arizona had the second largest number of residential schools and boarding schools. Oklahoma was the first. And my auntie, mid-century, was a counselor at the Phoenix Indian School there. And I become very interested in the way my family's hyper-nationalistic assimilation is intertwined in some ways with the development of the historical development of these schools. So thank you for that, for bringing that to my mind.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Well, thank you very much, Professor Tung, Charles, if I may, for a lovely conversation. We could obviously go on for much longer. And indeed, I think we didn't even get to all of our questions. So I'm hoping that, Mary, you can help us sort of feed those to Professor Tung for further follow-up if you'd like to. But with that, I'm going to give you the last word, and then I'll hand it over to Michael. Do you have anything you'd like to say by way of conclusion?
I forgot to thank Professor Hirsch for that excellent question. And just to say a warm hello to him. He's one of the professors at Georgetown, whom I remember fondly and with great gratitude.
Great, thank you. Thank you for your time. And I'll hand it over now to Michael Scott.
Thanks, Father Joe, and thank you, Charles. Another of the professors, I think, at Georgetown that you worked with was Michael Collins. And he'd probably want me to say this, but remember As You Like It, and the fact that when they go out of the city into the forest, the line comes, there are no clocks in the forest. Shakespeare.
Thank you for that.
Shakespeare was looking at some of these things through various patterns. It's been fascinating afternoon. So thank you very much for it and for participating and getting up so early to do that. thank you, Joe, for asking the questions today. Our next event in this series will be on Thursday, 9th of December, when Julia Lamb from Georgetown will be discussing Julian of Norwich And again, Joe Simmons will be conducting that session. Please note, though, the change of day. This is because Julia got clashes with her teaching. So it's Thursday, the 9th of December. The next free speech project is Crossroads International Dialogues event in association with the Future of the Humanities project will be on Monday, the 13th of December at 11 a.m. EST, 4 p.m. BST, when we'll be discussing issues relating to climate change. And we have some really top class speakers for that, the following COP26. I heard today it includes one of the climate advisors to Obama. So that would be a terrific time when Obama was at Paris for the last climate change. And there will be a Zoom in our China series on February 3rd of December, when Alexa Alice Jobin from George Washington University in Washington, D.C., just down the road from Georgetown, she'll be discussing Asian embodiment of a white canon, Shakespeare and the Sinophone world. And we'll be talking about the way in which Shakespeare has been changed and been performed in China and other countries in the East. Please note again a time change for this talk, due again to the fact that the lecturer is teaching. This will take place at 1:30 EST in the USA, 6:30 p.m. in the UK, and that's on the 3rd of December, Alexa Jobin. So I'd like to thank those at Georgetown who have made this happen, especially our administrator, Mary Gordon, who works to make the Zoom presentations possible. Special thanks as ever to Catherine Temple at Georgetown University for feeding the questions to Joe. Hello to Julia Morello, who's just joined us to help with these in the future. Further thanks at Georgetown to Dr. Jack DeJoya, the president, Dr. Tom Banchoff, vice president, global affairs, the Campion Hall to Nick Austin, the master of the hall, and Sarah Gray Yingying, our Campion Hall administrators, at Blackfriars to Richard Finn, the director of the Las Casas Institute, John O'Connor, the regent, King Arona Gabnai, the administrator for the Las Casas, and my personal thanks to Maggie Scott, who helps me with the administration. Finally, our thanks to you in the audience for being part of that audience. Please join us again for some of the events I've just mentioned. In the meantime, take care and keep safe. I'm Mike Scott. Please follow me on Twitter at Mike Scott Prof. Thanks again to Charles and to Joe, Father Joe. Thank you to you all, and goodbye.